Let's go ahead and get going. You know, we've got an action-packed agenda here, as always, for today's grooming. And I think I alluded to the topics that we're going to be covering. And so for today, should we choose to accept that we're going to be talking about the search experience, and we're going to be talking a little bit about the completion of that checkout experience, which is order confirmation, as well as implementation of some of the great work that Salmi has done on the UX side, which is editable cart. And so you'll see, you know, with every session, we're continuing to make really good progress, not only on what we've designed, but also, you know, the dependencies there within, right? And so, you know, perfect example, you know, bargaining folks are taking on the beginnings of authentication. Well, you know, one of the first things you want to do with authentication is order confirmation, right? Being able to go into that and see from there and begin to see what an order looks like. And so next week, looking at things like order details and other experiences that we've got the beginnings of, you know, certainly using the Luma reference theme as a starting point, but with all the great work, again, and research that Salmi and team are doing, really pushing the needle as much as we can for a reference theme that is progressive. So so that's what we've got in store for this morning, this afternoon, depending on where you're calling from. Any questions or comments before we get going? All right.
Hi,
let's go ahead and get started.
Hi, it's Kimberly. I just wanted to say hi. I saw your tweet, and I actually had a day with no meetings, so I just wanted to join and see what's going on with PWA.
Oh, perfect. Welcome,
hey,
Kimberly.
Fantastic.
Thanks.
Excellent. Yeah, for this, we're going to get into the details of what's coming next, and then so we've got some great partners here on the call who've really been helping us, you know, carry things, especially around the Venya theme. Starting off with some of the checkout experiences onwards to some of the back-end experiences to support that, which has been great. So you've got a good cross-section and really a good set of eyes on what we're doing this moment as we kind of run things openly through these groomings. So just a little bit of context there. But yeah, thank you so much for joining us. So let's go ahead and start off with something easy. I think the search piece will cover a good portion of what we want to cover for today. Search is always a big one, but I do think there's something we can start with on that one. So let's start off with something that I think does have some recency here. And again, just for housekeeping purposes, you'll see for the items that we're covering on Fridays, they will be marked 4. So we'll start off with where we left off again at the last demo, which of course is advancement of that mini cart. And so just for reference for those who've seen the current mini cart, Jimmy and team did a great job of kind of starting that, and we've got some examples from the bargaining folks building into what that experience looks like. And so as we add to carts, we've got the basics of that, but you'll see pretty quickly we need the ability to edit, to remove, to add to favorites if you can. And so we advanced the design from that perspective. But ultimately, we need to come back around to that, because that inherently certainly completes the experience, but also really pushes where we need coverage, or if we have questions on both the REST and the GraphQL interface into Magento 2. And so this is where we landed. And so again, this is what we like to do here, is just cover the basics of the story, and then of course add any details where we see fit. So I set these up earlier this week for us to kind of take a look at and consider. I took the screenshot from Salmia. This is part of the larger prototype that we're sharing with the community, but just as a reference. And from there, we want to advance essentially where we've got today with Venya. In this case, it's just the Summit Watch, but then adds a little bit more details from the Friday details, in this case, sizing, coloring. Quantity we certainly have covered, but then the ability, of course, to edit and or remove, which would be great. And so so this one's going to be interesting, but I think carry with what we've created so far. But from a total user story standpoint, as a shopper, we want to edit, remove, and then again add a Venya item to favorites from the checkout so that you can make an accurate purchase online. Let's say you bought too many shoulder dresses here, you need to adjust that. Maybe you don't want it at all. We want to accomplish that and make an accurate purchase. Mine. So what does it entail? Again, this shouldn't surprise you too much. Updates to the mini cart itself, and of course the abilities to do the add to favorites, edit, and remove. We're making some assumptions, of course. Thumbnails are already being pulled, so that's helpful. But there are some elements of product detail that we want to pull into this and start to think about some of those larger cases where, let's say, 4 items turns into 444 or 40. Things like that we have to think about when we start to implement this, But we'll make some assumptions with this being a very base case, but and identify future stories afterwards. In terms of the tasks themselves, you'll start to see a pattern here. First step, especially with the committee taking a look at this, we want to allow for some time of discovery to understand how it's currently implemented. We also want to allow the ability to begin implementing edits, remove, and add the favorites. We can certainly break those out as need be. Thumbnail's already there, but there are some basic product items in there, title and details per the UX. And last but not least, looking out for James here in Austin, testing and documentation. What we have here needs to fast follow with some documentation so that people can set this up. So that's what we've got. Again, we're just this should be pretty familiar for those who were at the demo. We want to start looking at this and start extending this. Any questions, comments, clarifications, or even concerns about this? What do we think?
Is there a place to view favorites?
There will be. At this point, there is not. So it might be a good question for Soumya on the favorites piece. What's our thinking on the location of that so far? Have we had a chance to think about that yet, or do we think we'll come back to that later?
The question that I would ask is, would that be tied to guest or would that be tied to account? Mm. It would depend on if we want to do it for both or if we want to do it for one or the other.
Yep. Yep.
Okay. So if we're working on this, for example, and we have an add to favorites, at this point it would just be adding the favorites and then just checking to make sure it's in the favorites. We're not necessarily displaying them anywhere in this issue.
Correct. Yeah, okay. This would just be noting it, and then we would cover the ability to view those at a later time. So okay. Yes, this would be, and then it could be verified by checking some things behind the scenes wherever that might be. But yes, this is just the facing version of that.
Cool. And part of that is we haven't had that discussion about favorites yet. I mean, it was a more sort of long tail item.
Yeah.
And so we'll get that discussion going on our end and have a better answer for you on that shortly.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah, and I think if we want to break this down a little bit, maybe we can edit this a little bit and kind of separate favorites from the other two. I like the idea of keeping it there, and which allows us some discovery. But if favorites kind of takes us down takes us into a kind of its own body of work, that's okay too. But we should make a quick call for whoever takes this and put that into a different story as need be, so that we're making some assumptions that this is fairly straightforward, but might be more, and that's okay. For that one, so I'll break that down.
I had a question about the individual items as they're displayed in the mock there.
Hey, Rowan, yeah, absolutely. What questions do you have here?
So are you able to swap back to it just for a sec?
Absolutely, let me just update this for posterity. Yes.
Yeah, so what happens to those line items if I have more than one thing in the cart? Because it looks like it's showing like just the price for one unit and the total at the bottom. If I have like four dresses, will it show me the total for four dresses, or is it just going to show me the unit price?
So the price is cumulative of all items you have in your cart. If you had two times of the trouser, then that number added to the total that already exists. So the cart total is what you see at the bottom.
I meant for each individual line item there. So there I'm seeing like, one times 163. If I have two dresses in there, I don't see, is it a case of I just see the line, like the item price, and I don't see how much I'm spending on that particular, those dresses?
Right. I see. Yes, that's right. Right now, that's how it is. But I mean, it's up for discussion if we want to talk about updating each line item.
Yeah, I was just kind of thinking. I didn't know how common that might be. I mean, certainly on a fashion site, I can imagine you're more likely to just be buying one of each item. But I'm guessing if you're buying, like, I don't know, if it's socks or something, then maybe I am buying 10 at a time, and I kind of want a view on how much I'm spending on each type of item rather than just the individuals. But
this is something that has always puzzled me about Magento specifically and its sort of inline editing of the cart item I have exactly the same questions as you, and I don't actually know. I've never seen in the fashion vertical that UI implemented as well as I want with expansion and contraction. But that's really, it's more of a UX question. I just want to register that I also am puzzled by this. And I think, Salmi, I've asked you about it before.
Yeah, we've talked about this. The thing is, Venya is a very specific vertical and a very specific representation of that vertical. So I would say that the larger decision we probably have to discuss is, do we want to provide an example for the use case of when you want to show updated to updated amounts for each line item for those use cases? There are other specific things like this. I mean, even with navigation, right? Good practice is to probably not have more than three or four levels, but there are many merchants like Bike Paths, for instance, they have frequently 7 to 8 levels. And the way that our navigation is designed right now, I mean, I've been discussing this with Jimmy, there's no way to easily switch from level 7 to level 3. The nav goes back to the top every time you close it. And so do breadcrumbs inside the nav, breadcrumbs on the page, like how are we gonna allow them to do that? Do we wanna provide an example for that? Because in Venya, we only have 3 levels right now. So it's a similar question for the cart. I'm happy to discuss the experience around providing accurate prices for each line item in the cart, but it would have to be like, are we doing that for Venya, or are we saying, if you had that use case, this is how we recommend you deal with it?
Right.
And to be honest,
I like the question. I think we should note it. So go ahead, Rowan. Sorry.
Oh, is that better?
Yep.
I was just going to say, from an outside point of view, like, I'd be quite happy hearing the answer of you saying, no, we're building Venya for this specific use case as a kind of MVP, and therefore we're primarily focused on like single item purchases, as opposed to like building out for a grocery or hardware parts order.
Yep.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, that was kind of the reason why I left it the way it is, though I've had discussions around this with Zetlin and others before, is I don't know how much extensibility of experience we want to demonstrate with Venya, but it's definitely something we can consider for the component, the Peregrine, the library we have to say,
yeah,
you know, here are a few common use cases based on what vertical you're in, and here's our recommended approach for dealing with that from a UX standpoint. And they're going to customize it how they want anyway. We have very little control over what ends up happening, but we can definitely offer sort of the expert point of view on what we feel that could work like.
That
makes
sense.
Speaking as a consumer of these types of components, just in the persona of Freddie, the developer who wants quick tools, I would urge that this not become one of those components that has 2 pages of configuration options. I would much rather that the line item concept, which Jimmy has implemented in a very generic way, be something that you plug things like this into. So the line item display itself would have extension points for adding interactive functionality in line and for modifying its, you know, size or its connections to data, rather than having a Peregrine component where you can check a box that says, also you should be able to see this and also this. In that latter case, which is common among React components, and I don't like to see it, in that latter case, you've given yourself the job of trying to anticipate every type of use case that people will want. So we can always just build something that accepts modification and extension from the developer side, not like in a Magento sense, even just from the dev side.
Sure, and it's very difficult to anticipate every use case around a certain component. I mean, I would think that the probably the optimal thing that we could provide, even if we wanted to, is just the most common or top 3 or the top, you know, 2. You know, we've seen this occur more than other use cases, and here, and this Venya deals with this, but if you wanted to do this other one, here's how you could do it. But yeah, I don't think that we can cover every, it's not possible to anticipate, you know, and what percentage, you know, that is really worth that effort of, you know, documenting and trying to extend for all of that, right? That's the question we have to answer too.
Well, fortunately, in what my opinion of the best practice is, the documentation burden is the smallest because you don't have to document a whole bunch of alternative invariant behaviors in the first iteration of the thing. You can just say, here's where you drop in X, and then you can implement X if you want to satisfy the story. And in the case of this implementation, as opposed to others where I've said, just do it, I would really strongly urge the implementer to do it that way. And I would review the code in light of that. So be warned, I'll yell at you on GitHub.
Okay.
So, not you, Sam, because I wouldn't yell at you on GitHub, but I would yell at you on Vision.
Yes. We have a sassy Zetlin on Friday. So no, I from a product standpoint, I agree. I think there's a lot to be said about keeping this simple. I do like the fact that this simple case actually embodies what a high-end fashion retailer might be, and the fact that you're not going to be ordering four of these tailored trousers in that size small and such. And so I think that's okay. I think we have to allow for some breathing room for some of those extensions,
and
knowing that this isn't there.
They're probably not using their website. They're probably coming to your house with a fitting consultant.
Yes. I think if you guys are okay with this, I put a couple notes for us to assign some research maybe in the future once this is hardened a bit, and then look out for extensibility points in the future, making sure that with what we do that those cases could be achieved for the right situation. But I think it's a good conversation to have and good questions to have as part of this. So.
Mm-hmm.
Cool.
Thank you. That's great feedback, Rowan and Zetlin.
Excellent. Anything else on this particular experience? So we've talked about extensibility. We've talked about favorites potentially being maybe a stretch goal. Anything else though?
Do we need to discuss what the proposed flow of editing looks like for this one, or no?
That would be helpful if we're up for it. That certainly would play into any estimate. So,
I can share my screen and demonstrate what I have at the moment, if that would be helpful, or I can talk through it either way.
Let's share. I'd rather this be a little bit more interactive and go into some depth, because I'm hoping somebody can take a look at this and say, okay, I have this, and I do want to get a good estimate out of this, and so I think that'll be good.
All right. So let me share my screen. I think you may have to.
Yep.
All right, so we hit edit items. So there are two use cases I'd like to kind of make transparent here. One is that you want to add the same item in a different configuration. Like you really like those pants. You say you want them in navy, but you also want them in maroon or whatever other color. So that's an intentional, like I want two of this product in two different configurations, which would be dealt with by either clicking on the thumbnail or the title of the product that takes you to a PD page, and the flow is exactly like if you were to just go to the PD page and add that as a product. The only difference is that it's a repeat visit. For edit cart, what we discussed was that the configuration of the product would be abstracted and would stay within sort of the cart space. So you click it, it shows you the configuration parameters for that item with the call to action to save changes and a call and the header that says you're editing the cart item. So you make your changes, you save them, it kind of updates in the button, just like we have on the add to cart button, and then it pops you back into your mini cart and tells you your cart item has been updated. That's currently what I have based on internal discussions. All feedback is welcome, of course.
This seems like swipe actions.
Sorry?
This seems like did you consider and reject swipe interactions for this?
I did because it's challenging on iOS, and we're kind of more in an Android facing pattern, and so after many discussions with Jimmy, we decided to go with the dots pattern for technical reasons and also for extensibility reasons. On swipe, we would have to consider doing like a drop down of actions within a couple of areas, like if you've seen on WhatsApp, if you've ever used that, which is a bit messier and fat fingering would be a With this, it's kind of a, it's its own menu, so we could add more items to it if we needed to in the future, you know, merchants use case dictated that we needed that. So just felt like this was the least frictional approach, all things considered, unless you disagree, in which case we can discuss Swipe again.
No, I don't. I understand what you're saying. A swipe action really can only be a one layer deep, can't it?
I mean, it can be more than one layer deep, but I feel like it's slightly less elegant in this context. I mean, for things like a messaging app, you do have need to sort of nest a lot of functionality within a single tile based on if you're in a group conversation or a one-to-one and so on. This case is a little bit more simple, especially with Venya. Okay. And I just feel like, all things considered, this type of solution is definitely more simply extensible, and it's a known material inspired or material pattern. So I just think that it would be a bit more intuitive.
Okay. Yeah, I see it. I think I'd have to use it in an implementation. But I'm convinced provisionally that it's not like a huge missed opportunity for Swipe. I just kind of wanted some context.
No, I had the same feeling as well. I think we really have to keep a close eye on some of these interactions as they span across iOS and Android to make sure that, you know, that it is, you know, because we were essentially creating a reference theme that needs to serve both, right? And so if we have to make some concessions like this to serve both, I think, you know, if you were to look at a list of principles, I think that's something we should consider. So I think it was the right, I mean, it'd be great if we could, but I think it would have been a trade-off otherwise. So I think that makes sense.
And I think all things considered, we're really not, we're sacrificing some pizzazz, I suppose, because that's kind of a cool thing that you can do that maybe you couldn't before. But I think from a practicality and just usability standpoint, I prefer the solution that we changed to with the three dots, because that's also understood, the ellipses or the three dots immediately indicate, you know, there is something there that you can click into, whereas with Swipe, there would be a learning curve for people to say, when they first landed in the cart, you'd have to somehow indicate, this is the issue we ran into with testing, right? When people discovered it, or when they were told that it existed, they felt it was like, it was really cool and they would like to see that. But the fact is, not a single one out of the 10 discovered it on their own. And so we would need some kind of, you know, help tip the first time they landed to say, hey, guess what? You can swipe and do more things with your cart item, which, I mean, I feel like that's a bit of a hack. If people are not thinking to do it, then it's probably not ready for it yet. I mean, we can definitely continue to push in that direction and do more testing to see which is the best way to expose things like this and also help the user develop a different habit than what they're used to. But considering the timeline and the requirements we're working with and all, I felt like this was the better solution at the moment.
Yep. Okay, very good. Any other questions or comments before we get to estimates?
Yeah, I wanted to ask about the spinner for adjusting the number of items in the cart. Is that assumed, this is kind of an obvious question, I guess, is that assumed to be like just the default HTML input, or are those little arrows meant to be touch targets?
Touch, which would open the response I have is, I'm thinking about it more now. I was assuming, or the assumption in my mind was, that you would tap it and it would give you that little roulette, oh my God, what do you call the gambling machine?
I think we do just call it a spinner, right?
The slot machine kind of thing at the bottom of iOS. Or it could be just your keypad that comes up and you enter a number and it updates. It could go a couple of different ways. I hadn't discussed with Jimmy or anyone else sort of where we were landing, and it's open to discussion. We can go with, it's sort of a utilitarian function, and, you know, whatever is easiest for people is what I would probably lean on. I sometimes prefer the keypad because it's just straightforward. You tap a number and you're done, rather than trying to, you know, do that depending on how many items you want. I assume you would not display more than 10 and probably not want more than 10 of a thing, but
yeah. No, that makes sense to me. I think it was just that because there was an indication on there of the arrows being either like gray or black, depending on whether you could go up or down. Yep. So I just wanted to make sure that it wasn't intended that those were actual touch targets for up and down.
No, they would be,
just indicating that you can go up or down from there.
Sure.
Yeah, I mean, I think part of that is we're not allowing them to, or at least the last discussion on that was they cannot delete the item by making the quantity zero. They would have to go to the dots if they remove item. So that arrow would always have to be gray, anything beyond one, because there's no way to further reduce it. And it was just meant to be a visual indicator that you can't go to zero. But I haven't, that was a result of the previous cycle of testing, and I have not tested this after that to make sure that that communication is actually going through. But that's something we could test, and if it's of no value, we just don't show the down arrow when it's at the least quantity that you can go to.
And then the other one was probably just a consideration for estimation. There on the edit screen, it looked like in the particular example, one of the colors was disabled for like presumably not being available in that size or something like that.
Yep.
So I think that would just to make sure that presumably any changes on that edit screen are also invoking another API call to double check that it's like, oh, you changed the size, we may need to update the available colors.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's functionality we currently have in the PD page. Jimmy had that in mind when he did the product detail page, and I was thinking it would be literally quite the same functionality. It's just you don't have the impression of leaving the cart, because that kind of muddles it. I mean, you leave the cart, you go back to PD page, we would have to load a lot of function in that add to cart button to detect whether you're trying to edit or whether you're trying to add another one of the same configuration based on where you came from and so on. It just makes it a little messy. This way, the two paths sort of separate.
Cool. So it's literally the same component being reused.
Mm-hmm. Anyone else?
That makes sense, and we'll add the screen from Sami here to the details and stitch those together just for posterity, so that's easy. So I may ask her of a favor after this.
I can push them into the shared community prototype.
Perfect.
They're linked up, so they should be. People can travel.
Yeah, easy enough. So okay, very good. Yeah, and so anything else that we wanted to add before going to estimates? Any questions, comments, clarifications? This is really good, by the way.
Just quick question. So does this issue include actually implementing that update page with those API calls we're talking about with the color displaying and everything, or is that going to be a separate issue?
You got to my question on that one, which was this is starting to get to be a very healthy side story at this point. And so what we want to avoid is, you know, these really massive ones are just hard to break up.
Yeah.
So I would like to envision a world where we separate the two, and I'm glad I'm not the only one who felt the same way. And so, because I think there's enough here, certainly with add to favorite, which is already a stretch goal, remove, which might be an easy one to start off with. Remove's always easier because it's just destructive. But then edit, maybe we can make a couple small changes here, and then just show the beginnings of some of the changes that happen, and then carve out, and maybe that's what we do, that second pane, that full editing experience, and then clone most of this, but then sure that is taken consideration. So I think your notion has convinced me to do so. And so maybe for the purposes of this estimation, let's just consider this experience, and then we can come back. I'll set up the next one. Either we can do asynchronously, or maybe we just queue it up for next Friday. I'm with you on this one. This is starting to get pretty big.
Yeah.
Okay, cool. Thank you.
Yep. And nobody wants to take a 53-point story. That's no fun. So.
Yeah, I kept raising my estimate. I was like, oh, this is looking like a 7. Oh, it's looking like, oh, no.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, that's a good point. So I'll clone and so create another one for you guys.
The reason that I suggested what I suggested is that if you observe this to be a collection of composed together bits of functionality, the card item itself, and then a place where injected interactive functionality goes that gets bound, and then as an example implementation of that, then that's a natural place for story separation. But it's incumbent on the developer to suggest that split so that Eric can write it down. I can do it. I don't want to stomp all over everyone. I'd like to encourage people maybe to see what I'm seeing, and if they can see along those lines, then start volunteering that you could take one of those things, like just the base implementation of the card item that doesn't have the editability strategies, and then also an acceptance criterion of that story would be that you add a place where such a thing would go, you know, a place where children are injected that get bound, that kind of thing.
Yep. Makes sense. All right, so now with our streamlined version of the edits, removals, and favorites, how's everybody feeling? Do we feel like we've got enough here for an estimate? Some uncertainty. Maybe we should at least get the. Maybe why don't we try the estimate and see how we feel?
So, can I ask if the screen share is still there? Is the screen share not there anymore, or am I just missing Blue Jeans functionality?
You know what? I think actually this is me. We switched with
that.
Sorry.
We can all see the screen. Kidding.
She's kidding. There we go. All right.
Great.
Can everybody see the screen?
Seen it. Love it.
Excellent. Sharing is caring. So let's get to the edge of the estimate here. So again, you guys know where I'm going to start on this one. So what are our thoughts on this one from an estimation standpoint, now that we've got just a clean single panel here? We'll do the other one next.
Well, us at Bar Green are thinking 3.
All right. The bid started 3.
I am pleased at that confidence. I would have said 5, but feel free to argue. If you think you can get it done in less than half a sprint, talk to me about how that task breakdown would go, and I'll be convinced.
Well, just from the streamlines we were talking about, it sounds like the only real API call and Redux action we're going to have to implement is the remove item. Everything else is not really going to have an action associated with it. It's basically just a UI build out. Unless I'm misunderstanding something about the issue, but to me that sounds like that could be done in half a sprint.
In addition to that, we've worked with this cart thing before, so we kind of understand like how all the parts fit together.
That's the last thing we did.
Yeah.
Yep. Okay. And then how do you feel about the uncertainty around the add to favorites? Do you think there's enough at least for you to tackle that with at least from a presentation layer standpoint, or do you feel like you need a little bit more of an estimate to at least consider that? What are your thoughts on that one? That's the one that worries me a little bit because it's a little bit more ambiguous.
As far as a favorite screen or just clicking add to favorites and what that does?
Clicking add to favorites and being in a position to verify that it has changed, you know, that is, you know, essentially checked off that state of some sort, being able to verify that that's happened.
Yeah, I guess that is another API call at that point. I think that sounds like a bit of discovery, but as far as the Magento API documentation, I've felt pretty confident about looking stuff like that up. It seems like they're pretty well documented. It doesn't seem like it would be too much work, but I could easily be convinced that this could turn into a 5. Like, I'm not super hard set on the 3. That was just my initial reaction.
Sure. No, that's good that you started that. We're just trying to pressure test this one, so.
Yeah, I think that's a fair point. That's some more research to do.
All right.
Do you already have some standard UI for like a toast or something? I.e. when I do add to favorites, there's like a little added to favorites message that pops up.
Did you say the toast?
Yeah.
I've never heard that one.
Yeah.
I've always heard snack bar.
It's perfect.
Oh yeah, I think actually the cool kids do say snack bar now.
but a snack bar is the shape, right? Whereas toast is, it's referring to how you're being toasted for having accomplished an interaction.
Yeah.
Oh.
Well, it's nearly 5 o'clock on a Friday here as well, so my mind's in a different place.
Understood. You're thinking, so, yeah. Think about that toast.
Yeah, I have so I think if that functionality so is Rowan, already there.
Yeah, I think Rowan, on this one, I think we've given some thought. I don't believe we've covered that yet with some of the work. So I think we're open to some. For this, I don't think we need to worry so much about what that reaction might look like on the screen. But I do think at some point we need to come back around to that. So it's a good point. I would expect I would expect this to change kind of in line. But I think that's open for us to come back around to.
I would say that whatever it is, they should all those actions should probably, except for the remove, which would ask you for confirmation. I would follow the same thing that we're doing for cart item updated, which is at the top of the screen, where it says added to favorites. That way, the expectation of seeing the result of an action is always in the same place, and it's not changing for every action.
Got it.
Oh, and so is there a component that does that already, or would that be something to build from scratch?
I don't know if it's built already. The model for it has exists on other pages that haven't been tackled yet. That would be a question for Jimmy.
Okay.
I'm not sure. Is he?
Let's note that. I know Jimmy's out today, so but I'd like to note this one. So, Tommy, could you fill it out a little bit for me real quick so I can capture that in terms of the research item?
So we toast notification pattern has the toast or notification pattern from the marks been implemented on any other page?
Cool. All right. That'll be a present for Jimmy when he gets back on Monday. Excellent. All right. Good questions, though. We'll put that on. And so I'm feeling with some of the questions we have, there's a little bit of ambiguity on some of these things, none of which are stoppers by any means, but it does, to me, feels like it adds a little bit of weight to the estimate, which again is okay. I would rather, I'm feeling better about a 5 versus a 3 on this one, because there's some room for interpretation and back and forth. That just without any more, we're not going to be able to get those questions answered. But again, not enough to stop things. What is so with that in mind, what does everybody feel about a 5 on this one?
That sounds great.
Yeah.
All right. Can I get a second for a 5? Any
second?
All right. James,
you got James Kalman has
seconded it, so excellent. Very good. All right. So let's go ahead and close this one out then. So we've got. So this one concludes the editability of the mini cart. I will clone this one and then again get the latest from Soumya on the details page of that one. That alone, based on what was perceived to be a short story for today, will probably take a good chunk. And I don't want to just do that ad hoc. So we'll move that to the top of the list for next week to make sure we got all those taken care of, but also include some of the learnings from this. So let me go ahead and save this one out. There we go. All right. So we've got one of these done, which is fantastic. So we've got approximately 18 minutes left here until close. I'm a little worried about opening up search with that limited amount of time. I'm happy to do so. I from a product standpoint, I'm very eager and excited about search, but I do worry about this. Let's cover something that's a little bit more straightforward. And if we have time, if we do that very quickly, I at least want to introduce the idea of kind of a very minimum search to at least get us thinking for next time. How does that sound? All right.
Yeah.
So this good. So let's talk a bit about. Oop, I put the wrong. It's the wrong screen. This is not good. All right. So let me. So we're going to take a look at the updated order confirmation for Venya. What you're seeing here is not the updated order confirmation. I've got the wrong screen, but the story is. I think I've got this on. Yeah, it's a clone. Sorry, guys. So the updated order confirmation is 267. The idea here is to take with what we've got on the confirmation in the Venya prototype, which is this guy right here. So I've got the screenshot ready for this, and begin to link together some of the experiences that we've got in the checkout. So as you guys remember, when we start off with Venya, we go through the process, go through checkouts. These guys aren't merged yet. Don't worry. That's the shipping and payment method. But then at the end, we have an extremely basic creation of an order, but it doesn't include some of the niceties that Xiaomi's put together, which is the order number, which seems basic, but we still want to pull that out. The beginnings of where we would link to for an order detail screen, which you'd want to know after making a purchase. And then the beginnings of creating an account, which then links to where Bargreen is starting off with that login screen. And so again, this one should be pretty straightforward. A lot of it's content, but there'll be a little bit of work pulling in some of the data of the recently created order based on things to get us going. So maybe more straightforward to understand, maybe a little bit more work on discovery. But that is that's the thinking there.
And looking at this, there's already something I want to change about that now that I'm looking at it after a while.
Okay.
We also need to deal with the case of if somebody already has an account.
Yes.
And is signed in or is not signed in. What is the prompt from here?
Yes.
Plus listing the email address as just text, but maybe it should be in a text field with the opportunity to just add a password or something and create the account rather than just not listing that or something. There has to be some improvements made there, I think. Something that I would like to see.
But we don't have customer account logged in customer functionality today, do we?
Correct.
So I guess for this scenario, this screen is perfect because we only have the scenario when we have a guest. Guest did check out, we collected all information from them, and then they just click create account. And of course, there is a lot of problems with it. They have to enter the password, and if customer has custom attributes configured, that's another crazy scenario that doesn't work perfectly today in checkout. So yes, we'll have to iterate on this a couple times at least. But for now, this is like the very, very good product. So we don't need the customer create account page. You do checkout, then you create account.
Yep.
So my point, maybe you weren't that doing that point, but my point is I think we can start working on this. And it would be
yeah, great. I mean, I was just saying not for this particular story, but I think this page needs a bit more.
Yeah, sure.
Iteration is...
Tommy, I'm going to look out for you, and I'm going to say the reference design is work in progress. I agree with Anton. I think what we want to do here is to advance this and start to think about linking together some of the things that are in flight and building off what we've got. So I think it achieves that. But we will not declare this final until we get to that point. But I do want to link in some of the work that's being done on the authentication piece, which this is a perfect place to do that and start to pull in data around that order number, which you still haven't done yet. And that alone is probably a nice story in its own right.
For me to understand, so this story will go to next sprint or next iteration?
We haven't done sprint planning yet, so we're going to estimate this first and then see who it'd be interested in taking it. So it depends on the size of the estimate.
But to clarify, this story will be about implementing this design, and then Samia will iterate and we will add more stories. And more
exactly.
Good.
Yep. And an N plus one we'll do for this one. So let's take a look at this one. I think this will certainly carry us to time here, but I wanted to kind of go start off with what we had here. I'm going to change out the image here based on what we've got here. But the idea here is, and the story is right, as a shopper, I want to have immediate access to the order that I placed after checkout so that I can check the status at any time. What's interesting about this one is technically it doesn't. The actual linking to the order itself doesn't require authentication. You can go into a guest scenario, so that's kind of nice. For that continue shopping group, which of course would dismiss this in the scenario that we have, and then create an account would be stubbed out initially, but then linked to the work that Bargreen has picked up for that one. So that's the idea here. And then so as a shopper, you want to be able to go back to that order. It's really just a, this is copied over from search.
I can update the thing with the screenshot.
No worries. I was in the process of cloning this before grooming. So for this one, it's simply just a, what we want to do is simply just an extension of current order confirmation. A link to order created and let's see, how would we characterize the rest of this? Oh, and then, and then a link to account login, basically. We'll take out my account login authentication. So that's a connected story.
You can use the update screen via Slack.
Okay, perfect. Thank you. I'll add that post haste. Excellent. And so these are the three items, and then the assumptions would be, of course, utilize existing. Let's just do this. Current checkout experience. Assumptions would be dates. I'm trying to figure out a way to capture the states where this isn't necessarily covered. Authenticated states, authentic state of confirmation future. So the idea is that you wouldn't be asked to go to an account if you're already authenticated. That's not part of the story. We would just do links for that. The tasks themselves would be the discovery. So be able to do discovery to retrieve order.
What do you mean by discovery? Like discovery and like just figure out how to do it, or
figure out how to do it. Yeah. So if the community was to take a look at this, being able to we can't assume necessarily everyone.
But the result of this story, when it will be ended, it will be implemented. Right? Those are just subtasks.
Absolutely. Yep.
Okay.
Yeah. Some of the tasks are more just because of the nature of this. Depending on who picks this up, there is some experimentation on how to pull an order either from REST or from GraphQL. I won't dictate necessarily what that will be.
By the way, just for maybe makes sense to just add as a comment for someone who will be implementing it. This functionality would be implemented in current checkout, and I think there is a REST endpoint for
okay.
I can double check. Create customer from order, something like that.
Okay, perfect. And so the task is so we've got that. We'll reference the current checkout in Luma, in the REST call from Luma, future considerations for order details. So this is identifying that once you basically, there may be stories based on the design where we leave off with, and then of course testing and documentation. But essentially, in its most basic form, it is just a creation of this. And so the idea is to go there and be able to create an account. Simple as that.
And do we have a page for when, so you click create account? It obviously will have to ask you for password, right? Do we have those pages?
We do. We groomed that one 2 weeks ago, and the Bargreen team's already taking a look at building that. So they're building that ahead of time, and we're creating the experience here that would link into that.
I'm sorry for taking time, but I don't understand. So this story is about, so you click create account, password field is shown, you enter password, create account, and then you have different some new screen that says, okay, so we created accounts.
Well, this would actually just go to the creation of the account experience. That's all handled under a separate story. This one's supposed to be very simple, where it's just this screen. The other screen has actually been groomed and is being done.
Why not in this story just not create one, show two password fields? User enters account, same as it's done in current checkout. User
right.
enters password and it just says we created your account, because we already have all of the information from customer. We have address, we have email.
Right.
So the only thing that is missing is password. They enter password
right.
and account is created. Because checkout is effectively the same. That was my understanding of the
right,
story.
Right, right.
Maybe I missed it.
It could be. I think it just links to something that already does that. So I think we have it covered. But please keep me honest. I can show you offline the experience that's being built right now for the checkout. I think it's being covered. And essentially, this is just linking those together.
But what I'm probably not concerned. So the experience that you mentioned, is it a
yep.
form to create a
yeah.
account?
Yes.
So my point here is that because we already have all of the information on
right.
this stage, so that's order confirmation page, right?
Right.
So that order confirmation page, we from here we don't. We, it's a bad. It will probably be a bad experience to send the user to create account for, because that would be weird. Why do I need to fill in the form if I already filled all the data during checkout? Right? Because during checkout,
right.
I specify email.
Right, right, right.
How it works today is that you go through checkout, place order, and there is a button, create account. You push create account, you see password field, you enter password, and that's it. Your account is created.
Right.
So from here, I thought that it would be simpler story, right? Like, would it be this, or would it be just a link to create a custom registration form?
Registration, but what we can do is pre-fill that with what we could still take advantage of the information that we already know. Like, I don't know if necessarily you'd want to have a password right here necessarily. But if you want to show that can be
what
done.
I'm trying to say, to say a lot of things. So this would be much simpler to do. Like, here, create account, you show two forms, at password, and you basically do a REST request that is already a thing happening today. It's available today. So this is something that could be quickly implemented, and this effectively, we don't have to wait for that story. The custom registration form is important, but it's, I would say, lower priority than just creating an account from order.
Sure.
So I would, again, you decide, but I would say that this story with the password fields would be much simpler, much more granular, much more atomic thing that can be done.
I do get the, I think your point is, if I understand right, is independence, right? If this is created independent of the other one, then I could see that. So that makes sense. So we can clarify that where you would create it. But then when we create the other experience, they would be stitched together and we wouldn't necessarily
Be independent because that other experience from here, you don't want even in desired state and final scene, you don't want to send user to customer account creation form. It would be, they would be like, it's an surprise effect. They already used to experience that they have on current Magento checkouts. I think they have on other stores where you filled all your information during checkout. Why are you being redirected customer registration? Do you already have all information? Just take that information from the fields I already filled and just make me an account.
Right. Yep, that makes sense.
Okay, so yes, but that's...
All right, let's see. On this one. So let's talk about where we left off on this one. So we've got... Again, this was a copied... Sorry, guys, we're in vertigo here.
No.
All right. So for this one, I think the story's still intact. You want to have immediate access to the order, so they can check the status at any time. The assumptions is you're using what's in the MVP. The coverage is there. Reference design, of course, is work in progress. Tasks, I think, makes sense, but I think what we want to do is, I think Anton has a good point in terms of the independence of this versus the other screen. So I think, it would be great to let's see, future considerations. It'd be great to have a situation where we simply would just ask for a password for the create account on there, and that would just be completed before we would link this. And so basic password confer. All right. So I think we got a little bit of work to kind of show what that looks like. So maybe some annotations. So I can work offline with Sami on that one, and just at least get the ball rolling on that one. But I think we've got that idea covered. Future considerations. I think we can take. I'm not as worried about that. And this is copies and search. That and that. Reference design. I will copy this. And I think that's it. So in terms of the basics, again, we're still pulling in this information. We're going to use as much as we can to create that account, which would be the completion of this particular story, and that's it. And so, so assuming that we can all, in the back of our mind, see that visual and how that works, what questions do we have? What questions? What can we clarify on this one for the beginnings of what an estimate might be? What are we thinking here?
Well, it sounds to me like this would be potentially blocked by issue 250, which is account creation. Am I right in thinking that?
Actually, I think this, the way that Anton just described it, just unblocked that, where you could potentially create a stub. There's basically a stub temporary experience created off of this. That in time when 250 is created, we would remove that stuff.
Well, my point was it wouldn't be even stuff; it would be final design because that's. I remember I talked to Semenenko, who was product owner for checkout, and he mentioned it as the best, it's a good experience where you are not redirected from order created page. You are not redirected to customer account creation form. You just the account is created for you from the information from Orca. So it wouldn't be, my point is that it wouldn't be temporary. Yes, we would need a customer account creation form separately, and there would be a link from product page, from categories pages to that page. But from order creation, we already have all the user information. So the only thing we have to do is to do a request to Magento, get user password, and do request to Magento to create account. Make sense? Let me go get my laptop, and I will check if there is a REST endpoint. There is definitely a controller for this, but I'm not sure if it's exposed as web API. So I'll check. Okay.
It does.
Well, I think we're. It does. Okay.
Yeah. Yes. I mean, I got it in. Yeah. Hold on a second. I was just looking at the APIs. Which does everyone here understand, by the way, how to call up an actual like REST API Swagger doc that's complete? Because it's if you're experienced with Magento, it's pretty straightforward. If you're not, then it's weird.
He's talking about the Magento Swagger.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, we've done that a couple times.
Okay, y'all know how to do it, and y'all know that you know you need to actually have an admin token in order to see the full spread.
Yeah.
Okay. Good. So yeah, so that REST API endpoint is at least partially implemented. Anton, are you looking for like a specific piece of functionality in it? Because there's a whole admin token or login token and reset token API implemented.
No, I'm looking for the endpoint that says create account from order. So here's order ID, yeah. Create account from this order, customer account. So create account by order ID and password. So here's password, here's order ID, please create account. So Magento retrieves all the customer information from order and creates account for user. So user doesn't have to retype that information.
Okay.
Let me get my laptop. I'll check if there is already the REST endpoint. So you can call it, but I'm not sure if it's exposed as REST API.
Sure.
The thing I'd ask, yeah, as like a final bomb to lob in before I run off to a different meeting, is do you consider this somewhere where this would be component reuse? Like you would have a single component that is collecting the account details that may display them as form inputs or may display them as pre-filled forms that is used in both locations? Or do you consider these entirely separate components that are just happening to submit to the same function?
I would say they should be separate components that each receive a copy of the same or similar instance of something that actually performs the action.
I missed part of discussion, but my point, I don't think we need a registration component here. I mean, there is just a button, so maybe you have some misunderstanding. So my understanding is the best practice for checkout is that you place order, you see order confirmation page, you are offered to create account. You push button, you see two password fields, or they can be there. You enter your password twice, and then create account, and that's it. That's all you do. The account is created for you in order, right?
Yeah. That makes sense. Well, let's do a couple things here. I think we have some research items here on the create account from order for Anton. So let's take a look at that. But I also want to take a look at the UX and kind of where we left off with this. I know we had some ideas around this, but I think we all understand the need for utilizing what we already know about the order to create the account. So I just want to do a quick review of that. So maybe I can, again, being respectful for some of the folks in Europe where this is fairly late at end of time here, let's tee this up for next week. This is a good discussion for that. But again, super appreciate everybody's time on this one. I'll finish this out based on where we've got, but I'll mark it as work in progress. But we'll talk again about it next week. So
great. That makes sense to me.
Cool.
Okay. Yep. Well, thank you so much, everybody. Have a great rest of your Friday, no matter where you are, and we'll talk soon.